He's mainly involved into web and mobile development. He's inspired with the movie Her and is into machine learning. Rajat Gupta, applause, please.
Hello, guys. I am going to present today about ChatOps, and I will make sure people don't sleep during the talk and people should enjoy. So first of all, I'll tell about a little bit myself. I'm a developer at ThoughtWorks. I'm Python lover. Mostly I code in Python. And I love also DevOps and ChatOps, and also into the machine learning and deep learning module. My Twitter and GitHub handle are RajatGupta712, RajatGuptaRG, if people want to follow. Yeah. So let's talk what I will cover in this PPT, in this talk, in this session. First of all, we'll look on what is ChatOps, and then how it works, what's the overall idea, and what is the architecture of this whole ChatOps thing, and what features it offers, and what are the possibilities it can offer. And we'll see a demo, obviously. So yeah, what is ChatOps? So if I want to define a one-liner word, one-liner sentence of this ChatOps, what is it all about? I'll say it DevOps with better communication for teams. So we'll look on there how it is DevOps with better communication for teams. So first of all, let's go into the DevOps. What is DevOps? I think everyone knows here about DevOps. What is this? So DevOps is when we write a code, what we do generally? We code, we build on some CI tool, we test it out, write some tests, we package them, we release them, and we configure the VMs and all on which we have to deploy our software, and we monitor that. So this is all the overall life cycle, and if we look on the DevOps, it's a intersection point of all these processes. It's a intersection of the quality assurance, development process, as well as the operations that we do for the deployments or apps. And yeah. So now, let's come to another part, better communication for teams. So if I look on the better communication of teams, I'll come up with how the communication flow works in the team and why the communication is necessary and how it's going to affect the productivity first. That's the most important thing, how it's going to affect the productivity. So in the most of the companies, people work in an agile fashion. What they work in a flexible manners. They have no fix. Once we develop complete whole software package that we're going to test, it happens all things together. We are QA, devs, DevOps guys, all sits together. And the communication should flow within the team for the better productivity. Everyone should be aware of everything. It's not the developer should, developer don't know what's going on with the DevOps. The QA don't know what's going, how the deployments will work or how the code is written. None of the ideas. So that's why communication matters. People should be aware about what they should do, what they should not do, or what's happening in the team. That's all the overall communication. So once people are aware of the things, in the team, how the product is, how the code architecture is, then they will become responsive. And that's why it increases the communication in the teams. So the blind spot in the team is DevOps mostly. Developers are working for long time, but they still don't know what's happening in the DevOps, how they write some piece of code, they don't know how it's going to be deployed. So these are the things which is kind of a blind spot for everyone, in some of the teams. And so it increases the communication, and developers knows what's going on, what's not, what is wrong with this deployment, or what's wrong currently in the environments. So that's how the better communication increases the more responsibility and awareness in the team. And yeah, obviously productivity will increase if people become responsive and they know what's going on everywhere. So they have the context of the whole product, including the development to the deployments. And that's important, that's the most important thing. So as a summary of this, I will conclude it like, what is DevOps? Operating DevOps over a chat, that is our DevOps. It increases awareness in the team. It increases the collaboration. Like people will collaborate more among each other. The knowledge sharing, that is the most important part. People will share like, yeah, dude, this has wrong, this is not wrong. And the transparency and responsiveness will increase in the team. And hence the productivity will increase and you will get a good hike. So like, let's look on how it works actually. Like how the DevOps will work over like chat, how things works. Let's see. So you have any IM app, like it can be a Slack, it can be a HipChat, or it can be any IM app which supports the APIs to connect to the messages. So any IM app which have, so HipChat and Slack have the very good APIs to connect to the this platform, and you can listen to the messages flowing into the channels. So I'll prefer Slack, like because they have really wonderful APIs. You can connect and you can perform hell lot of operations on there, on the platform, their chat platform. And so now how the chat ops things came here. So there is a bot which is also a member of a IM app, and that bot will listen to all the messages flowing into your IM app, what people are talking or what people are sending messages into the channel. So this is a bot. It listens to the messages, and for every message it processes what the message is and what's the intent of that message, what's that message wants to say, and it takes the desired action according to the message, messages are intent to say and what we need to perform, and it performs and gives back the reply to the user. So it's just like you ask something, the bot will listen, bot will act, and bot will reply to your actions. So this is how the flow works here. It's just a normal conversation. And so I'll come to this part, the bot part. I'll say, is it a bot really? It listens to your IM apps, it observes the behavior, a sentiment like of the messages in the channel, and it replies back according to the message's intent. But I will say it's not a bot. It was never a bot, actually. It is a platform which have the abilities to integrate lot of features into it. So suppose you have 10 teams in one company. It's one company, one team uses AWS for their deployments. One company uses GCP for their deployments. Another one is DigitalOcean or their local data centers for the deployments. So it increases the complexity in the system. Like one platform should deploy to any of the providers, any cloud providers or your local data centers. It has the ability to integrate with that. And also we will not work all the time while we are in the office. We'll have fun or we'll do our general things also. Just like if you want to travel to some place, you booked a flight, what's the status of your flight? You do want to go to some flight status app which shows you the flight status, or you just look at the same chat platform. It can also gives you that. And similarly, the general utilities that we perform daily, we can also integrate with this platform. It's a plug and play model. You just write a plug and integrate with the platform and it will work. And similarly, for the fun, like IPL is going on, hey man, what's the score? So it can also tell into the messages app. So like, yeah, one thing for every purpose. It can be like more fun. So I'll say from now, I will not say it's a bot. I'll say it's Samantha. She's here for help, to help us for every possible way, in every possible ways. And yeah, let's see. Now I'll come to the architecture, like how actually Samantha works. What's if you see overall what Samantha listens to messages, perform it, and replies back. What Samantha performs and how Samantha performs. That's the most important question. Like actually, it's a DevOps, how it controls a lot of things, which we'll not like thinking right about it, about them right now. So you have your own laptop, you have your own machine, you have your own mobile, which have the IM app installed. So I use Slack for them. So just like for reference, I'm taking Slack as the like IM app. People will send a message to the bot. They might send it into their mobile while having a juice or coffee or having a lunch. And Samantha will listen to those messages. And now things come like anyone in the team can do all this stuff, like the authorization, there will be a fear of losing power, like which is more dangerous. Like if the DevOps guys in the currently team, they don't allow you to deploy the things randomly, there will be a particular time, or there will be some particular users, like X person should deploy, Y person is not allowed. So like that's why, suppose it like our team is consist mix of BAs, QAs, developers, everyone. So like the BA guys should not deploy, but they should know what's the status of the deployments. That's how, why the communication is important here. That's how the communication flows. So for this, we have an authorization layer. So authorization layer will take care of everything, like whether the user is authorized to access the particular particular feature or particular plugin or not. Authorization, or even though the user is authorized to perform the file the messages and all, is it really, like suppose your QA is deploying the services, like which is actually a QA should deploy, but suppose a PM is deploying the services, that is actually not good. Like you have a microservice architecture, like anyone can deploy, but there will be like if it's a big service, big architecture, then you need to give the access to some certain number of people. But everyone should know, that's how the context flows in the team, like what's the status. After the authorization layer, here the machine learning comes into the picture. So what that machine learning module does, it takes the a particular command or particular messages from the user, read that message, and it gives you the understand the sentiments and know what and understand what the user wants to perform. So it will be like I want to provision two instances on AWS, it will understand, yeah, that's a valid command, I'll do that. But if you say like let's hang out, like that's then bot will obviously say no, because she's working, she's not like you flirting all the time. So that's why the machine learning model comes and it gives you the proper command, proper action to the whole platform. So after the machine learning, it understands the sentiments, prepare the whole objects, and it gives you which thing should run. So how it works, suppose if you say like you want to deploy two instances on AWS, so it will first of all look on the what is the VPC ID you wanted to assign, or what's the subnet you wanted to assign. Do you really want to assign a private IP or public IP to the instances, or do you want anything into the instances like Nginx, or you want to attach with a load balancer. So all these things are, so the backend is written in a Ansible. scripts are not written. The machine learning model, Samantha, tries to write the Ansible playbooks itself, and based on the parameters and all, and it will trigger the Ansible playbooks accordingly to provision your infrastructure. And also, if it's a shell bash, then it will run your bash commands as well as, or if like you can, I am actually mostly coded in Python, so I use Python for writing my own plugins. So it will try to run my own plugins, or you can write in any language like which provides an API to access those modules. That's how it overall works here, the architecture is. So what all the features are written in all these things. So if you have any microservice architecture having a hundred of microservices running on, like you have a five different environment like QA environment, user acceptance or staging environment, production environment, and like it makes like monitoring all the time, all the APIs, all the microservices becomes difficult. But Samantha will monitor all those things. It's not just deploying, it's also used to monitor. It also gives you the alert and notifications when needed. It also sends you the SMS. It might happen like you are out of internet coverage. So Samantha sends you the alert using SMS also, and will try to notify these things are not working, or if the deployment fails, the whole team also knows about the what fails and what doesn't, what is working fine. So I also talk about like fear of losing power. So that's most important thing. Like suppose in your team you have a certain like five two people who does the DevOps, and those two people's like only they do the deployments. But if you are giving everyone like some more like everyone power, everyone like power to everyone to deploy the things, and like then people will have a fear like what will happen, how we come to know like who deployed the things. So when you fire our deployments, alert goes to whole team like this user tries to deploy this thing, and that's how everyone will know like, yeah, this is what happened, what time, and yeah, people will know like when and what time deployment fail out, who tries to trigger the deployment. So every time you will have a power, every time you have a control over the system, and every time you like, so there will be a features like deployment windows, just like mostly in most teams have. And also if you don't want any deployment window, but you want anytime you want to deliver a piece of software, but by a certain number of people, you can also do that. So that's power of the this whole platform. And obviously you can do a lot more things as I discussed. So if I talk about features, what features it offers? So on-demand infra provision, like what I saw in most of the like what generally people do if they want a new environment for the their development, they ask from their technical support team. They say like, yeah, I want these VMs for these environments. Can you please give me? And it might take 1 day or 2 days, actually, which is very costly. If like 1 or 2 days will be very costly, and this thing will give you on-demand infra provision. You just say, I want a QA environment with two machines for 3 days. It will give you the whole QA environment with the desired specifications, and it will automatically destroy your environment after 3 days. So this is the, and the environment will automatically immediately will start provisioning. That's why you don't need to wait. You just need to say to Samantha. Samantha will react. And APIs monitoring, similarly, you have a microservices, you have a thousand, hundred of APIs. The Samantha will monitor all the APIs all the time, and it will notify you over all the possible ways, like if something went wrong with the status, every obviously, and the logs if you also configured. Deployments to the cloud or local data center. So we talked about like, yeah, deployments can be done to AWS or Google Cloud or the your local data centers. These things can also be done through that. You just say, like, I want to deploy 2 VMs on Google Cloud. It will do that. It won't ask you, like, it won't confuse about, like, whether what is the Google Cloud or what's the AWS. And alert notifications over emails, chats, and SMS. If something went wrong, you deploy, something went wrong, and it will give you the alert. Or if your services start failing, health checks start failing, it will do that. If any VM is running out of memory, it will do that. It will send a notification for you. And obviously, if you want to have the instance details, like you are running on, you have your infrastructure on AWS, you wanted to see, like, how auto scaling groups when triggered the new instances, or when it goes when it does the perform the scale up, or when it performs the scale down features, it will notify you. And you wanted to know the particular instance specifications, it will also do that. You go to the chat, ask for the details of a particular instance by the name, not with the IP and all. It will give all the details, what's the memory status and what's the CPU performance and all, what's the hardware configurations and all, what's the IP address, what's subnet, what VPC it is in. So these all things it gives. Also, it gives you much more, like as I mentioned above. It gives you the cricket scores. If things are like IPL is going on, World Cup is going on, you can always ask for a cricket score. As well as, like, if you are a football fan, you can also integrate a football plugin which always tells you about the scores and all to have fun in the team. Also, like, flight tracking, as I mentioned, and like, you can also about, like, if you want to search anything, like, you don't want to go to Stack Overflow, you don't want to go to Google, you just ask for the in the chat, it will give you the proper results. And that and also it has the capabilities, like plugins or can also have the abilities to crawl the data, to get the data, to give you the desired response, and all these things. So now let's about what are the all the possibilities that can be happen. So one thing, like, we all concerned about cost of the infrastructure, which is also a costly. So it can destroy the infrastructure when you don't need an infrastructure. It just like you ask for an infrastructure and you're not using it, it can destroy and save your costs of the infrastructure. So that's how you can save money. A cost effective infrastructure is like, if you say, like, I want this, like, 10 services running on AWS with like one MongoDB cluster of 3 nodes. It will do all these things for you, and which is especially like the scripts are written in that way, like, it will save the cost for you and also saves the time. So people might face a problem in creating a database cluster or something. You just say, like, I want a database cluster of 5 nodes for MongoDB. It will do immediately. So that's how it saves the time. Everything the machine learning does, you just need to give your requirements, that it will try to write its own playbooks in Ansible, and it will try to trigger those. And similarly, the future scope, like, if you want to see, like, hey, I want to go to Bombay, how can I go? Like, what's the minimum price, like, if I'm going on after 2 days? You just say, like, yeah, like, Bangalore to Bombay for after 2 days. It will give you the minimum fare of the flight. That is also a very important thing. Like, you can perform you can add as much features as you can, and it will try to perform all those things. So, yeah, I'll try to show a demo. Yeah, obviously. So, here I'm just talking normally, just like warming up my day. I came in the morning and, like, I don't want to work right now. I just want some mind freshener. So, yeah. So you can ask for, like, yeah, she can talk normally with you also. It doesn't, like, everything not ends up with work. Oh, sorry. Here you can ask about the what's the status of the deployment, can we deploy today or cannot, we cannot deploy today. So I am asking from it, and what's the, so I have a service running, what's the status, like it's called as booking service on, I want to test the status on UAT, user acceptance, so it will give you, things look good, service is running fine, if something went wrong. And I also want to monitor that. If something went wrong, I should know immediately what went wrong. So I am asking, like, can you please monitor that booking service for me on UAT? So it will monitor. It will start monitoring, and whenever it fails or whenever something went wrong, it will immediately notify you on the production, I will ask. So yeah, it started looking, and whenever it something fails, it checks you, it sends you the notification over chat or the SMS, whatever the feature you want to add. And yeah, if I now, like, I want to test, like, can I deploy things to my QA environment? Like, can I provision AWS environment for QA? So it will check, yeah, can I really provision my environment? Say yes. But now I want to provision my UAT infrastructure. I want to create a user acceptance criteria testing environment for my product, for my service, for my architecture. And yeah, I'm not authorized to perform this action. It checks either you are a valid user to perform the deployments, or you are not a valid user, or it is the right timing to deploy the things, or it's not the right timing, and it will try react according to that. And yeah, I'll say, let's say the flight status, like, rather than typing, I'll just say flight status for the flight 91. Like, I am just traveling to somewhere, I just want to check what's there. So I'm just giving a flight number 9W412. Yeah. What? It will also gives me the whole result of that flight, what's there and what where the flight is going, what's the time. And these are the some of the coolest feature you can add, you can integrate by your own, and it will work according to that. So this is the all the things you can do with this. Yeah, so I'll ask for questions. I think people will have a question. Yeah, from the bottom one, from the, yeah. It's not an open source. Actually, the deep learning module that is there, which actually performs the whole things and the infrastructure, the Ansible in whole infrastructure is not open source. Yeah. Sorry? Prices. So it's a product that is not, like, we don't offer this product for another company or services right now. So it's just for internal purpose right now. But it's, we can make it as a product and sell it to the other companies.
What's the underlying bot technology?
So as you see, like, underlying technology is like Slack is for IM apps. The most of the whole engine, that deep learning module, the Samantha is coded into the Python. The infrastructure is written in Ansible, and the Python code tries to write the Ansible playbooks by its own and tries to trigger them. The notifications, the alert, everything is written in Python.
Okay, my question is, from a security perspective, say someone hacks in and takes control of my Samantha, and he gives orders on behalf of me, and is there any multi-factor authentication or like multi-level authentication which I can set?
So,
like some key questions, so that those are only validated for the different kinds of orders.
Sure, you can obviously do that. If it's like you wanted to ask for a multi-factor, two-factor authentication within a Slack or within a HipChat or any IAM app you want to assign, you just say like you want to provision something. It will ask what is your like your key question that you have set like that no one knows, or it will try to send a SMS on your phone. Just type a code of that phone and it will trigger it. You can do that. It's possible.
Also, we need to train the Samand, right?
Yeah.
With our questions and answers.
Yeah.
How can we do that?
So I wrote most of the data for myself, the grammar. So the grammar itself and the models and what they should return. So it's just one time effort you need to put. After that, it will. The data is written in that way, like you, I want to provision, I want to create, I want to make an environment. So all these messages have the same intent. They have the same intent what they are trying to say. So these data are trained in that way. And when you are opting this, when you're opting Samantha for you, you don't need to train with much more data. You just need to make a couple of changes and train your model with that data. That will not take time. So there is always a one configuration file which is always resides. What is your service is you need to configure. It accepts the configurations in two ways. Either you can configure your Samantha over a chat, or you can put just a configuration file and it will and come to know everything. So suppose you want to deploy your AWS, Samantha should know about your AWS access key and secret key. Similarly, so it's just one configuration file, you put everything there. It will try. It will use those things and will come to know about your whole infrastructure. Samantha will do all the things.
You said that your Python code writes the playbooks, right?
Yes.
What is the need for that? I mean, these playbooks might be more or less very static, right?
So it's not a. Actually, the roles are static, not the playbooks are static. Roles need some parameters that. Suppose you want to provision a VM that needs a parameter as a what VPC ID or what VPC you wanted to create, not ID that you have to go to console then copy paste. That will be bad user experience. So you give a VPC, you give a subnet name, like in which subnet you want to sign a private IP or a public IP. So these things Samantha will ask you at the time of creation. When you say I want to create one VM, so it will ask, do you want to create? So its CLI is only for AWS. It's not for Google Cloud. It's not for the local data centers. It's not for other service providers. It doesn't monitor all the things. So it's just. So that's how the model is there. That's how the machine learning works there. You, based on the AWS, based on the Google Cloud machine learning, ask you the particular set of parameters. So the I want to provision the task requires the two parameters, VPC ID or subnet. It makes a dependency graph, tries to pass the dependencies and try to give a particular command object to the further. So it will try to execute that. Any more questions?
Yeah. Or for anything, we'll say Terraform or cloud formation stuff like that, right? You already give you the facility for doing it in a system. Why did you want to write it integrate? Like, make your bot write it integrate?
So that's why, the bot writes because you have to configure all. Suppose you are in what project A, you went to project B, you need to write it again, the whole stuff. Write it back. The Samantha won't do it. Samantha is already a core feature is there that is common for everything that you want to do. It just a machine learning model. You just ask like Google Cloud or AWS or any DigitalOcean or anything you just ask. It gives the machine learning model already trained for a particular environment. What's the role and what's that role needs, and it will ask particular things. And you don't need to write all the things again and again for next project. It's a scalable thing. It scales up for the different projects. You just put a configuration file, and it will start working. So that's how it saves a lot of time.
Excuse me. So are you using RNN for deep learning?
Yes, RNN. And some of the features are also using natural processing toolkits. That is also there.
Okay.
And yeah, it's a combination of mix and match both right now. But eventually, it will end up with RNN. Any more questions?
You talked about destroying the infrastructure,
yes,
which is not in use, right?
Yes.
So how it takes a call, on what basis it will destroy? But because why I'm asking is, like, later on you may, after 5 days or 7 days, or
yeah,
you may use it, right?
Yeah. So it's not a criteria for destroying the infrastructure. It's a criteria that you set something like when you wanted to destroy. Just like when you want to provision, when you at the time of provision, you just say like for 3 days, it will destroy after 3 days. Or when you have set it up that criteria, like if my infrastructure is not working for 5 days, inactive for 5 days, then it will try to then destroy the whole infrastructure. So that's how you can. So the configuration file plays a big role here. You have to set some parameters also into that.
So the configuration file is user based or like it's like company based?
It depends. Like if a particular user is using that or a company or particular team is using this.
Okay.
So, anyone can set that configuration file for themselves.
Okay. Thank you.
Hey, the last one, just on the other note, why did you name it as Samantha?
Yeah. So actually, I got inspired from movie Her. Actually, there was a artificial OS named Samantha, and the guy who played the lead role that fell in love with Samantha. The bot should be like that much interactive that you don't need to go to anywhere else. That's the overall intent. That's why it plays a plug and play feature.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.